In a world filled with war, hate, suffering, and Justin Bieber, two guys fix it all with a battle about a movie. One film, two opinions, one coin, two sides. They feud. You decide. It's time for Film Feud.
Hey guys, welcome to Film Feud, the podcast where we debate whether top-rated movies should be top-rated. I'm Vidur.
And I am Vikram.
So what exactly are we doing here, Vikram?
We choose a movie from the IMDB Top 250 randomly.
Randomly.
And then we toss a coin and assign each other sides and feud.
That's right. We feud. The movie we're feuding about this week is Up.
In the Air.
Nope. That's the George Clooney one. This is the Pixar one. Up.
Oh, animations.
With the balloons and the house and the ones, and I know you haven't seen it, but it's colorful.
Interesting.
Are you looking forward to watching it?
Yes, I'm looking forward to the coin toss a little more though.
All right, let's get to it. So how the coin toss works is that you will be tossing the coin. Heads is for, tails is against.
That's it. That's pretty much it.
Yeah, that's right.
All right, let's toss this coin. So I got tails.
Congratulations. You are going against this colorful, joyful Pixar movie. Any Pixar movie you go against, barring a few.
Right.
I mean, that's a tough proposition.
So before we go watch the movie, let's just do a quick shout out to our sponsors for this week.
So, oh yeah, that's a great idea. So who's the sponsor this week?
Sponsor this week is someone who's very close to me. A near and dear one.
Oh, that's nice. Somebody stepped up to support our little venture here.
Yeah, someone real. And with actual money and resources to be able to. Sponsored this week is my dear Gajju Chacha.
Oh, you have a Chacha named Gajju? Is there any relation to Raju Chacha? Star of the movie Raju Chacha. Played by Ajay Devgan.
Took me a second. I do not think so.
Gajju Chacha.
Chicky bum bum. I just remember that movie after God knows how long. All of a sudden, it's coming to me.
Oh, so this is a separate entity. That's great. Well, that's nice of Gajju Chacha.
Yeah, you can't just say Gajju or Chacha. You have to say Gajju Chacha.
I was going to say Gajju. It's a very American thing in me. You know, I just say first names. But yeah. It's Gajju Chacha.
Right, it's Gajju Chacha.
So what did he give us for this episode to sponsor us?
This bag of Parle G biscuits.
Oh, that's great. That's great.
Yeah, they're the best, dude. Parle G.
Yeah, because we'll need a lot of like nourishment while we're watching this movie.
Yep, that's the reason.
That's legit. That shit I can actually consume.
OG. He's OG, man.
That's awesome. Well, thank you, Gajju Chacha. Appreciate you sponsoring this episode.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
So with that, should we do this? Ready to watch the movie?
Let's go watch the movie.
Let's light it up.
Hey, Vidur. Thanks for waking me up, man.
Let me guess. You're an emotionless robot who didn't like this movie.
Dude, it took 3 tries to power through this movie. And I'm actually glad I saw it because lately I've been having some trouble sleeping well. You know, like life and work and stuff like that. And this movie just knocked me out cold.
You know what you should have done instead is told yourself that story. Just would have knocked you right out.
Yeah. But this movie.
One of Pixar's greats.
Nowhere close.
This movie was mind-blowing for an animated movie. Amazing for a normal movie. Amazing just for a movie. Forget animated. No qualifiers needed. Which is why I was nominated for Best Picture that year.
We'll get to that. But just coming back to Pixar movies in general. I actually googled this. They have like 18 movies in total that they've made. And it's just so typical. It's so typical. Templatized animated movie that a Pixar would just churn out year after year. I'm going to forget this movie in the next 3 days.
Every time you look at a balloon, a walker, a
Costco ball,
or a house, you will be thinking about this movie.
Or blimps.
Or exotic birds.
Weird looking birds, right.
Speaking of blimps, one of my bucket list items is to ride a blimp. So that was another thing that I was like just looking at this movie longingly for.
Right.
You just don't have dreams, man. That's your problem.
I did dream really well while I was sleeping, attempting to watch this movie. Dreamt so well.
You know what you should have done?
Mm-hmm.
Woken up.
Where do we begin? I'm so lost right now. This credits.
We begin in the beginning. The beautiful montage of their love for each other.
Right, right.
Carl and Ellie.
I don't even care, bro. I don't even care at this
point. Wait, what do you mean you don't even care? Are you that much of a heartless monster that you did not enjoy this like amazing short film within the film of this silent montage of Carl and Ellie's marriage?
Heartless monster.
I mean, just look at yourself. You're claiming that you didn't feel anything when you watched that montage?
I felt sleepy. That's the feeling.
You're such a robot. The opening was like, you know the opening credits to Bill Burr's show, F is for Family, where it's just like his
Come
life.
And get your...
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, 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 right.
It's just like his hopes and dreams are being crushed.
See, they show that so concisely. I am not interested in his life, right? I'm interested in what's happening currently, and that's the what the show's about. That's why I love it.
Yeah.
They take a minute and a half to sort of show his entire life, and they do it in such a nice way. And this...
And here they did it because this way it's more impactful in the end. You get his motivation, you get what he's going for. This to me was like the nicer, sweeter, more touching version of the F is for Family opening. It's like, yes, life is empty, life is bleak. Yes, life is awful. It crushes your dreams.
Oh, shut up, I'm sleeping.
But if you have someone to do it with, if you have your Ellie in life, it can be amazing.
How many times did you cry in the movie?
I shed a tear once in the movie.
Shed a solitary tear.
A solitary tear came out when she has a miscarriage and can't have a baby.
All right, all right. When she had a miscarriage, right? I remember that.
And I also may or may not have welled up at the very end.
At the very end?
When things work out, he's a changed... It's like...
I was actually expecting him to die, to be honest.
He's such an asshole.
No, as in, I didn't want him to die. I was expecting him to die.
Do you think the bad guy died?
For sure.
He had some balloons attached to him.
There's no way. There's no way that man is still alive.
He had a few helium balloons, man.
No, no. He's dead. He has to... That's the natural progression of his life.
Are you saying Carl is a murderer?
That was manslaughter right there.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, that's even cooler. Yeah. Like, look how much he grew. His character was just this grumpy old man at the start. And we all know grumpy old men, you know?
Yeah. I think it shows that men, women, human beings can grow...
And change.
In 10 days. Despite being the same for 90 years.
And it's, fly.
It's possible, and they fly. I mean, dogs flying biplanes and trying to like shoot a house down, which is... floating in the air because of helium balloons.
That was awesome. It was a perfect mix of fantastical and realistical.
There is no realistical in this situation. let me clarify that for you. And another thing which really bothered me was the supposed age difference between Blimp Man and Old Man. Are you following me?
Carl and Charles.
Okay, so when Carl's a kid, the first scene of the movie, Carl's a kid and he's watching Charles the Blimp Man. His supposed hero, who looks about 30 to 40 years of age at that point of time, right? Uh-huh. And then Carl grows up to be supposedly 80 to 90 years old.
He's not 80 years old.
Okay, 70 is...
Maybe, 70s.
Let's do it in the...
Can we just jump ahead to from your age point?
No, it's just really bothered me that Charles, who's probably 150 by that point, is...
He's not 150.
130.
He's just...
He's over 100.
He's an active 90-something.
How can he be an active 90-something when Carl is 75?
That okay, means... maybe Carl is 75. He was like 9 years old when he was watching Charles. Charles was like 29. Now Carl is 75. Charles is 95. And Charles stayed active with his dogs. He did sit-ups every day. He breathed the fresh air of Paradise Falls.
Paradise Falls, right.
There's maybe some symbolism. You don't grow old in Paradise.
Oh, okay.
You know? And they can have sword fights and walker fights and ride a blimp
and
stuff.
And also how Carl... I mean, we'll progress through the movie step by step during this episode. I have some gripes along the way, which I will bring up.
Shocking.
But, I mean, I don't want to fixate on... The plot holes and the technicalities.
Okay, because definitely, we will not fix it on the plot holes. It's right. A fucking animated movie for crying out loud.
Right.
Just to take a step back, this movie just captured so many things that a lot of animated movies don't bother with. Like, it wasn't just meant for kids. It captured what it's like to be a kid, of course. Then it's also capturing what it's like to be in love as a kid. It's also capturing the awfulness of life, which anytime a movie does that, I just love. It just showed that life kept getting in the way of his dreams, kept getting it, and then he just had to fucking fight for it, and then kind of settle with what he got in the end. And it captured what it's like to be like a grumpy old man, and it gives me hope for when I'm a grumpy old man, then maybe I can have some adventures and find a little fat Asian kid to accompany me on those adventures.
It's fine, dude. It's fine. That's what Pixar's doing. It's trying to play with your emotional cords, churning out a movie every year, which does the exact same thing. Just changes up the characters, adds a little story themes here and there, and the rough goal is still the same. To elicit the reaction that you're having right now. Toy Story days and stuff like that, they actually cared about the movie they were making. Now it's just money-making machines. So which is great as a business. It sucks as a movie studio.
It sucks as a movie studio. All of Pixar is being indicted based on...
I'm telling you, Pixar post 2002, 2003 has...
What was the last good Pixar movie according to you?
See, Toy Story obviously was the best.
What are you, like Carl's age? What do you mean Toy Story was the best? Pixar's made some gems since then.
You think there's been a better movie than Toy Story?
Wall-E, Finding Nemo.
Barf-E. See, Finding Nemo...
Barf-E is a different... Barf-E is a Hindi
Finding
movie.
Finding Nemo was still, according to me, during the golden age of Pixar. I think Finding Nemo came out 2002, 2003.
Uh-huh.
So up until then, they were great. Post that, man, I mean, they came up with like Cars and like... Ratatouille, and I mean they're all cute, Brave, and all these things. They're cute, nice movies. But they're just so templatized. Like I can't think of another word here.
Why are you even feeling the need to dig a hole for yourself where you're feuding against 10 amazing Pixar movies as opposed to just one?
That was
all these movies are amazing, and Up is probably one of the best of the lot. This was the only animated movie nominated for Best Picture. After right. Beauty and the Beast.
Yeah, let's jump into
that. What does that
as well.
Tell you that and your horseshit logic?
That tells me a lot because I think this was 2010 Oscars, and that's the first year the Oscars expanded their lineup for best movie.
So what?
So
still top 10 movies of the year. It's not a joke.
Wait, by the Academy Awards, again, we know how our opinions of the Academy Awards are so.
Sometimes they get the nominations right.
In this case, they did.
I'm not actually that sure who won that year.
This movie called The Hurt Locker.
Listen, if it comes between a movie that has a flying house and a movie that has like bombs and shit, I'm going with the house. It's a no-brainer.
Right. Bombs and shit.
Bombs, yeah. Isn't that what The Hurt Locker is about?
You've seen The Hurt Locker. Please tell me you've seen The Hurt Locker.
Many times, but what I took away from it was bombs and shit.
Bombs and shit.
Whereas what I took away from Up was adventure and balloons and colors, giant birds. Hurt Locker gave me none of that shit.
Before we move on from the Oscars, I actually had another thing I wanted to talk about. So Up was... for some reason nominated as in the Best Picture category. It was obviously also nominated in the Best Animated Movie category.
Mm-hmm.
I actually feel that was a better movie that was nominated in that category. This one called Fantastic Mr. Fox.
Oh, here we go. Here's the hipster Vikram coming out. I've actually watched Fantastic Mr. Fox.
It's great. It's great.
It's a mediocre film at best.
What
it's
are you
a high
talking
concept,
about?
Different form of animation. I give it that. It's like the Chicken Run of its time.
You did not like Chicken Run?
I watched it when it came out, so I don't remember too much. But it didn't compare to the colorful, joyous, message-giving, finely crafted piece
right.
that was Up.
You'll have a good time chilling with my niece. She's 1 and 3 months. She has the same affiliation to color and joyous and these stupid-ass keywords that you're throwing at me at this point of time. But coming back to it, Fantastic Mr. Fox was fantastic. The Roald Dahl book and Wes Anderson.
Oh, yeah. Wes Anderson. What did he do? Drink some espresso while going down the street on your skateboard while watching that movie?
Drinking an espresso while skateboarding. Never seen that happen before.
Just fucking untie your man bun and move the fuck on, dude. Fantastic Mr. Fox is not a better movie than Up. Anyway, why don't we just go through the movie real quickly and we can talk about all the things we liked and I don't know how that's possible, all the things we didn't like.
I'd love to.
So we already went through the montage, which just sets up the whole sequence of events
snooze
beautifully,
fest.
Perfectly.
Snooze fest.
Oh, go fuck yourself. And then his whole decision to like actually just fly his house when they first reveal the balloons and stuff. And it's so cute. He's wearing that little badge that his wife made him, the grape soda badge thing on his coat. That was the other point where I shed a tear in this movie. It's just touching. Touchy ho gaya main. And then, boom, dude, the house flies.
Boom.
Amazing.
Game changer.
It was a game changer.
Right. I like how the house just starts flying.
Yeah, and then everybody in the city is looking at it and marveling.
It's just like through like the skyline, touching buildings and just like flying through. No one's shooting it down. No one cares there's a flying house.
I will admit that if this was in post 9/11 America, it would be a little bit of an issue.
Yeah, like the FAA isn't even a thing. There's nothing on their radar that's flying around America. And just the whole fact that no matter how many helium balloons you can tie to your chimney, it won't.
The guy spent 50 years in and around balloons, okay? He's a balloon expert.
Yeah, subject matter expert, bro.
And he just applied it perfectly.
Right.
Became the adventurer he always wanted to be.
Yeah. Put a curtain on the left side, put a curtain on the right side, and boom, you have wings.
Boom, sails.
Yeah.
How do you think Columbus discovered America?
He's just like...
It was like the 1600s version of helium balloons. It's just slaves and wood.
This movie gives kids the wrong idea about flying, I feel. Because I would not be surprised if there'd be like a six-year-old out there who's like just bought like 10 helium balloons and just jumps off like 10 foot high.
Jesus, dude. That just went dark as shit.
That happened with The Matrix. So I don't...
One.
This one guy thought that he was in The Matrix and he could fly like Neo did, and he jumped off like 30 stories high or something and he died.
I remember this from the 90s when this happened with Shaktiman. Wait, this one kid thought that Shaktiman would save him and jumped off his house balcony or something.
This is the exact same thing that Up is doing.
This is not the exact same thing.
Up is telling you that, brother, if you have 15 helium balloons, hold them and jump.
No, they make it very clear that he's a domain expert.
Right.
And it takes a lot of fucking balloons. No kid just has access to the amount of balloons that they show that you'd need.
No, that's for the house. The kid would think that only I need to fly. Fuck my house. So I need maybe
one tenth of those. So the kid would tie balloons to himself and see if he lifts off. It's that simple. It's in fact encouraging kids to experiment. It's promoting a science-based mentality. Right. Go tie some balloons to yourself.
And see if you fly.
Also, why didn't some helium company product place? Like, this would have been the best opportunity to sell helium balloons I've ever seen.
Name two helium companies, Vidur.
Well, there's... all right, just because I can't name a helium company doesn't mean my point isn't valid. All right, so then... The house is flying. There's a whole flying scene. Then he discovers Russell is there.
Oh, Russell's that kid, right?
Yeah, Russell plays a really important role. He becomes a kid that Carl never ended up having because of the aforementioned dark miscarriage.
Understood. So templatized. Love it.
What do you mean templatized, dude? Yeah, movies are fictional. They're written by people over a long time. It's fine.
I don't think the Pixar movies are written over. It's literally you release movie A and you have 1 year to release movie B. Rejig the characters, rejig the setting, and boom. This whole Pixar story spine thing that I'm sure you know of, which is basically a studio creative, a Pixar creative sort of tweeting out this architecture as of sorts of a Pixar story, which basically revolves around one fine day, yada, 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 sets the scene of the movie, then this happens, and because of that, this happens, and because of that, this happens, and finally... this happens. And that's literally...
That's just a story. You just described a story there.
There's I described Pixar. Every Pixar story.
So what? That's a story. Yeah. It goes something like, there was a man blank. Every day he blank. Until one day he blank. Which led to blank. And blank. And blank.
And finally
blank. That's fine. That's just a story spine. I used to learn that improv all the time.
Oh, no. That's a Pixar story spine right there. Because
so Pixar makes it a little more formulaic. Okay, it's reaching out to kids, but it always infuses all these other messages in there that make it watchable for adults as well and sometimes profound for adults.
What was the message in this movie particularly?
Never meet your heroes.
Houses can fly.
Life sucks.
And dogs can talk.
Dogs can talk.
And fly planes.
Kevins can be female.
Kevins can be females.
Houses can be backpacks.
What a learning experience this was.
It's funny actually because I read this thing about Pixar movies that kind of summarized all of them like, oh, Toy Story, what if toys had feelings? Oh, Finding Nemo, what if fish had feelings? Right. Oh, Cars, what if cars had feelings?
Wall-E, what if robots had feelings?
I think this one then would be, what if old people had feelings?
Yeah, exactly, man.
Well, there we go. It taught me that old people can have feelings.
Never doubted that. Did not need an animated movie to tell me that.
This movie made me like old people again.
You dislike them?
I just wasn't in touch with them, you know? It's like, it felt like people I was scared of becoming. And in the first half of the movie, I am scared of becoming Carl.
Right. But the second half gave you hope.
Second half gave me hope, you know?
You'll find your exotic bird and your dog.
First, I'll find a girl.
Uh-huh.
Then wait for her to die.
Right.
And then I'll live my life for real.
Yep.
Fulfill her dreams.
Yep.
And then I'll open a book and it'll turn out that I was her dream all along.
Aww. Barf. Once they reach Paradise Falls,
the beautiful South American Falls of Paradise.
Which, firstly, I thought was the end game. So I was so happy. I was like,
but he wants to be on the fall. He's on the other side of the fall.
So they're going to take the entire second half of the movie to get to just the thing I can see right in front of me.
Yeah, but there's shenanigans and there's Kevin and there's the house as a backpack.
I think that's where the movie loses it.
I'll grant that it's a little tedious. Because a lot of new characters are introduced, a lot of new concepts, but it's like...
No, but that's usually when the movie sort of starts picking up. And this is where the movie just slides downhill. There's so much of the story that's yet to be revealed about his hero, Mr. Blimbroy. And all the dogs, I couldn't get over the dogs. They're talking with collars around them.
Can we just decide that we are not allowed to discuss or you're not allowed to hate on any fantastical element because it's an animated movie? Do you watch Monsters, Inc. and be like, how can there be monsters? What the fuck?
No. That's a fair point. Some of the stuff is super ludicrous, so I just had to bring it up, i.e. the age difference between the two of them.
You're obsessed.
So I won't harp on that anymore. I'll let that one be. All of those points.
I think what you're referring to is the pacing of the second act, which I get. It's kind of like the time is actually spent in... That's where the character development for Carl really happens. He gets more attached to Russell, the kid, and he gets attached to Kevin the bird without even realizing it. And really, the thing is, he's so obsessed with his house and his memories of Ellie and stuff. And this is the stuff that they lay the groundwork for so that they can show us why he's finally able to let go of these things in return for these new things that he's getting.
Completely understood, but they could have done that in a much, much more engaging way. It's the part of the movie which is not sad, yet it's the most boring part of the movie. And films tend to do that. They fall into that hole where a part of their story just becomes boring inevitably because they're trying to establish something or create some marks or something like that. But these guys, they killed it at that, right? Making it boring. Like, I think it was they were trying to do it on purpose or something. You lose interest in this movie so hard during that second half. It's unbelievable. And it slightly picks up again because of all the excitement in the end, but it just doesn't feel right.
You know what it reminded me of is, did you watch Kong Skull Island?
I did, actually.
You actually did? Yeah. I didn't expect you to say yes.
I did.
But it's like they go on the island and they spend time just showing what's on the island and they spend time showing John C. Reilly and his little tribe and what they believe. This was just like that. And Kevin the female bird, right, had such an important role to play.
Of course. Just holding the story back and bringing them down the entire time. The guy actually reached where he wanted to reach his entire life. And he gets there, and because of this stupid bird and this stupid dog and that stupid little Girl Scout kid, he can't do none of that or enjoy any of that, get some closure about his wife and their dreams, their lifelong dreams.
You've literally missed the whole point of the movie. You're actually talking about how he was a grumpy old man who was clinging on to the memories of his dead wife and seemed to be expressing the desire that he just cling on to the memories of his dead wife.
No, not cling on, but get closure. The movie ends on a note where he's much happier about the situation and he's chilling with the kid.
He's grown, he's bonded with the kid. He doesn't need the cane anymore. He's like Watson in the first episode of Sherlock. All this adrenaline, he gets moving.
Right. Adventure. So they show that happy point, but guaranteed if Up was a real thing and they would follow that story for the next 2 or 3 years, he would be more miserable than he was when the movie began.
Jesus.
100%.
So cynical. So, okay, according to you, what do you think Up to the sequel would look like?
Him just again start thinking about his wife. Oh, what if I was at Paradise Falls or whatever, chilling there? That's what my wife wanted. Why did I get involved with that Girl Scout?
Dude, his house is there now, just like the painting.
He doesn't know that. He saw his house floating away in the clouds. He's like, my house is gone. Ab mere paas koi choice nahi hai. Meko bachche ke saath rehna padega.
That's a good point.
That's basically what happened. He cut his losses. He's like, fine, the guy's dead.
He lives in a blimp now. That's awesome.
That's great. But he's like, I'm not at Paradise Falls. Trust me, Up to is him traveling to Paradise Falls and he sees his house and he's like, booyah kasha. This is it.
I think
that kid, fuck that bird. If that bird shows up, I'm going to shoot it. I have my dog because dogs are cool. But that's it.
Speaking of which,
I hope Pixar in like 2025 doesn't see itself in a situation where they're like, oh, we don't have the movie for the year. Let's make Up 2.
Let's reboot Up?
No, let's just make Up 2. That's what they did with Finding Dory and Monsters University or whatever the fuck.
All right, I think you made your ridiculous scarecrow from Wizard of Oz, robot from iRobot, heartless monster position quite clear here. So if you don't think this movie should be on the IMDb top 250, what movie do you think you would want to replace it with?
I would like to replace it with a Bollywood movie.
Okay.
Which was not equally dog shit, but slightly better in terms of trying to pull emotionality out of the audience.
Mm-hmm.
It was this Amitabh Bachchan movie called Baagban.
Baagban?
Right.
With Hema Malini?
Yeah, that one.
Why Baagban in particular?
So Baagban was a movie which forced people to cry. That was the intention of the movie.
So you're saying Up is like Baagban because it's just aiming for tears?
I'm saying Baagban is slightly better than Up at what it tried to achieve. Because I saw way more people crying when they saw Baagban as opposed to Up.
Funny story. I was actually in the first ever movie I watched in Wave Noida, Baagban. And I was sitting on the leftmost seat within my family.
Uh-huh.
That means I was sharing armrest with a man who I didn't know.
Right.
And this man had a cutting edge phone from the time.
Uh-huh.
A Nokia communicator.
I was about to say that. N95.
N95, I believe it was.
Yeah, yeah.
And so then the movie starts.
Uh-huh.
And hits all the notes where people are supposed to cry.
Uh-huh.
This man, this grown-ass man,
right,
is bawling. He cannot control himself. But he's wearing a half-sleeves shirt.
Uh-huh.
So he has nothing to wipe his tears away with. So what does he use? His Nokia communicator.
Wait, what?
He kept hitting his face with his phone to wipe the tears away. I haven't thought about Baagban in 10 years. I don't know where the fuck you came up with that from.
How many times did you cry in Baagban?
I couldn't cry. I wanted to cry, but this man next to me was trying to wipe away moisture with metal.
Fair enough. Fair enough. So that's my entry for the IMDb Top 250 as a replacement for Oop.
All right. Let me just summarize my thoughts. This movie hit all the right notes. Joy, sadness, laughter, life emptiness, never meet your hero-ness, old age can be fun if you make it-ness, love-ness, how to get over your wife dying, how to deal with all that. It was beautiful.
My summary for this movie is, your wife is dead, get the fuck over it.
Jesus.
Jeez, bro. I mean, get over it. Live your life.
Shut the fuck up.
Badly. So guys, that was this week's episode of Film Feud.
Thanks for tuning in. We feuded, and now you guys, the listeners, get to decide who won. Tweet at us at Film Feud Pod.
Also, our post box number. So if someone wants to write a letter,
PO Box Film Feud, Andheri East, Bombay 201.
That was always the PO Box, right?
Yeah, it was always
in everything.
East. When I was a kid, I thought Andheri East was like some damn happening place in Bombay. It was a shithole.
I thought it was like this big ass post office.
Anyway, guys, you should write to us. You should tweet at us. Just let us know who you think won. Me. Meh. Moi.
Had to put it in. But before we wrap up, Vidur, let's select next week's movie.
Let's do this. It's time to spin the Film Feud wheel. So we got number 239. Holy shit. Gangs of Wazipur, our first Bollywood movie.
Oh, man.
Oh, man.
One or two?
It's one movie, bro. Come on. I'm glad IMDb recognizes it as one movie.
Why are you glad, Vidur?
Because that's how the artist, Anurag Kashyap, the director, intended it. I just want to be fair.
This is going to be a fun coin toss, isn't it?
This coin toss matters, I think. I'll be the first to admit it. So just to be clear, we both watched Gangs of Wazipur. Both parts, even though I don't acknowledge that there are two parts.
All right, we get that.
Did you watch the two movies together when you did? Because I actually did not watch them in theaters, so I actually saw them back to back, which makes a difference sometimes.
It does, I agree. But I actually saw both of them when they were released, 1 year or 2 years apart, however long that was. I'm not too sure.
Let's just see. Is there some common ground here? It's the movie that made Nawazuddin Siddiqui pretty famous. He's pretty good. Are we not conceding that he's pretty good?
Maybe. I'm playing this one close to the chest right now.
Yeah, clearly you are.
This is going to be an interesting coin toss. So, yeah, guys. So, tune into next week's episode to see what happens.
And don't forget to subscribe on iTunes, Stitcher, or wherever you listen to podcasts. Thanks for tuning in.
Thanks for tuning in, guys.
Bye.